come tonight, so we do have three here, I think. We did one escape, but Dick.
One escape, yeah.
One escape, okay. But Richard Littlefield, Dick Valentine, and Mr. Dunham are here, so we've got three people, and I will probably give you a basic talk, because one of the problems about the Korean War is that most people don't remember what happened, or are very vague about it, very fuzzy about it. So I thought if I gave you a brief overview of the Korean War and the Korean situation, plus talked a little bit about the situation with the Bethel Citizen, which was the local newspaper record, which covered the event in this town, I thought you might have a better idea. Then we move to the panel discussion. We certainly want to hear from the Korean War veterans. They're the ones that really we're here tonight. But I just thought I'd briefly go over the course of the war and a little bit about what happened. At the end of World War II, remember, Japan's mainland possession of Korea was occupied by both Soviet and U.S. troops. The 38th parallel was the tentative boundary. The Soviets set up a puppet regime in the north. They were determined to prevent the formation of a free South Korea. When they failed in this effort, they vetoed South Korea's admission to the United Nations. The Soviets had only to maintain a minority of communists in power. The U.S. had to foster a democracy in a land where there was no democratic tradition at a great taxpayer expense. In June 1949, U.S. troops were withdrawn from Korea, leaving only some technical advisors. On January 12, 1950, the Secretary of State, Dean Acheson, in a speech that would come to haunt him, said Korea did not fall within the defensive parameter for which the U.S. would fight. Korea, he assured, would still remain under the protection of the United Nations. The lid blew off, of course, on June 25th, 1950, when the North Korean army, which was Soviet-trained, equipped, and presumably Soviet-inspired, suddenly lunged forward across the 38th parallel and with the object of overwhelming UN-sponsored troops in South Korea. The assault was evidently made with the expectation that weakening UN would not neither act would act too late or not at all. Security Council moved swiftly under proddings from Washington. The Soviets were absent in protest, remember, because they were protesting the non-ceding of China. On the very day of the invasion, the Security Council unanimously branded North Korea the aggressor, urged a ceasefire, and called upon the members of the United Nations to render every assistance in bringing about a restoration of peace. The long-dreaded shooting had now begun in the hitherto Cold War. The Soviets were doing the shooting by proxy through their puppets. The life of the UN hung by a hair. In 1931, when the United Nations, the League of Nations, I'm sorry, had quailed before Japan's attack in Manchuria, this seemed to be a case of history repeating itself. Truman had to move quickly. The American people in Congress supported the president in this cause. In a neutralized Formosa, and they sent forces in air and naval forces to resist communist aggression. They ordered unseasoned troops in from Japan, and the Gallup poll indicated 81% American approval and 13% opposed, with 6% with no opinion of that action. 16 nations actually participated out of 16 United Nations at the time. It was overwhelming, however, U.S. effort. The U.S. first the great bulk of naval forces, the supplies, and money, over $15 billion, except for South Korea, it provided most of the men. More than a million Americans served the Korean War. About 150 were injured or killed, including 33,000 battle deaths. In just about that year, the war really lasted before it got into ceasefires. All the forces were under UN authority. Truman appointed Douglas MacArthur as commander of the international force. At first, the tide of war went very badly for the UN. UN forces retreated to a small southeast beachhead. Then suddenly, on September 15, 1950, General MacArthur turned and caught the communist forces on the flank by an amphibious attack on Incheon, and they surrendered or fled northward toward the sanctuary of the 30th parallel, closely followed by UN troops. October 1950, MacArthur was vaguely authorized to cross the 38th parallel. South Koreans, however, had already crossed. The Chinese warned that they would not sit by and let North Korea be invaded. The Chinese pushed the UN forces back across the 38th parallel. The UN forces regrouped and regained lost ground. MacArthur wanted to bomb Chinese bases in Manchuria and blockade the coast. The UN Assembly condemned China as an aggressor 44-7. This reversal, inflicted by the Chinese, far from arousing American public, had the opposite effect. Soon the war was called Mr. Truman's War. A majority of Americans came to believe not only that was intervention a mistake, but the U.S. ought to pull out of Korea, and there was a variety of criticism was directed at the foot-dragging U.N. allies, who the critics maintained were willing to fight to the last American. MacArthur pushed for bombing Manchuria and bringing part of Chiang's army from Formosa to Korea. In 1950, the Sino-Soviet alliance, Soviets pledged to defend China and gave the danger of a full-fledged war for the Far East. It became necessary to restrain the headstrong MacArthur, as you all remember, who was summarily removed from all his commands on April 11, 1951. Truman, of course, was right in asserting civilian control of the military, but it was a major blunder on his part to treat a distinguished military figure and public servant in such a shabby manner. MacArthur came home a hero at Truman's expense. The Gallup poll showed 66% favored MacArthur, 25% Truman, and 9% had no opinion. The issue of the war on the Far East found the Gallup poll in 1951, 77% opposed, 14% before, 9% had no opinion. Truman realized rightly that it would be a mistake to fight with our allies. The British were very concerned with MacArthur's position. General Bradley, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, testified at the time that war with China would be, quote, the wrong war at the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong enemy. In June 1951, the Soviets proposed a truce, and the American people supported. Senator Taft called it an utterly useless war. 2 years of talks followed. Prisoners of war was, of course, the major stumbling block. 85,000 to 170,000 prisoners were refusing to go back to communist China. They had surrendered the promise of UN protection, and it was hard to go back on that word. 1952, Eisenhower promised to go to Korea if elected. December 1952, but took several months more. The Korean armistice finally came on July 27, 1953. Everyone was tired of war except South Korea's President Syngman Rhee, who wanted to reunite Korea. We don't find a lot of coverage in the Bethel Citizen on the Korean conflict. I read the whole, every issue from June 1950 to the end of 1953. There is some general commentary on events, but not much related to Korea. On November 16, 1950, there was a prominent space given to a speech made by the National Grange Master in Minneapolis at the National Grange Session endorsing compulsory service, stiff excess profit taxes, and generally a strong stand against the spread of communism. And this was presumably a view reflected by the editor, Carl Brown. In the January 11, 1951 issue, there is an article about doctors under the age of 50 who were to register for selective service for the Korean effort. And the next week is the now famous photo that was included in the Illustrated Bethel History of Gene Brown, Leonard Bishop, Waldron and Chester Osgood, and Elmer Dean with the Army recruiter Sergeant Shaw before they joined the Army. In March 1st, 1951, in that issue, there's an article on Sergeant Harry Swanson, age 36, who was the barber in Korea, but General Edmund Almond, ex-Corps commander. Earlier, Swanson had been MacArthur's barber and occupied Japan. Swanson commented that both generals were wonderful to work with, so we got that comment. What else would he say, right? Later announcement was that the citizen, the Lieutenant Colonel Vincent M. Witter, had received his second oak leaf cluster. He was operations chief with G4, 8th Army Headquarters. He had served in World War II. He was awarded a Bronze Star, Purple Heart, Combat Infantry Badge, and Italian War Cross. We also find one of the people here tonight, Herbert Dunham of Locks Mills, wounded in Korea. He spent time in a hospital in Busan. And on July 19, 1953, we find Sigurd Olsen, a POW. And he's the one that we don't really know all the circumstances, but it seemed that he had appendicitis. And the communist forces operated on him, but then they made him march without any recovery time. And as a result, he died. And but I don't think there's ever been, I don't think any remains have ever come back here. I don't think that's right. So when I talked to the family, that's what I got as the. Anyway, there's articles of registry for the draft, which appear in several issues. The body of Sergeant Joseph Coulomb was brought back to Berlin, New Hampshire. It was reported on the January 3rd, 1952 issue, where he had spent time growing up on the Flat Road. Major General Frankie Lowe of Harrison, Truman's representative on Korea, gave an illustrated talk on the Korean War at the Woodstock Gym. And of course, this was a great, very large American Legion meeting. One of the most telling things in the Citizen, I think, that tells us how Carl Brown must have thought, was on May 27, 1952, there was this cartoon, and it had a big cross, and then had all these little crosses around it, and the caption, "How many more?" So we gathered from that that Carl was one of those people that was opposed to the war. Stiles Bridges, it was published a letter in the Korea, in the Citizen on Korea, it was the Senate from New Hampshire, remember, supporting an agreement. He said, "We can't win in Korea, but we can't withdraw at peace, so we can't withdraw at all." So he was trying to, I think, make a political issue out of it. We had an article on General Aldous stating that he had been given the Distinguished Medal Service, Military Service Award, and the Silver Star. There was a lot of Cold War rhetoric in the Citizen during this period, and lots of general articles about civilian defense, etc., which we expect. Not really relating to the war, as the Korean War. It's important to think, however, though, that we have to look at perspective here. And in the however long you think the Vietnam War went, and there's some question about how long that went, from 10 years to 12 years or whatever the figure is, it certainly was a much longer war. And not saying anything to belittle anyone's service or anything like that, but the incredible thing to remember about this, about the Vietnam War, which lasted maybe a decade or more, 56,000 people died in that war, Americans died in that war, whereas in the Korean War, which was really the one-year period before the ceasefires and the real heavy fighting, was mostly during that one year, and 33,000 Americans died in that period. So it's important, I think, to keep that in mind. Because it does tell you something about perspective here. Korea has been branded the Forgotten War, and also it's been called the Younger Brothers War, because so many people fought in World War II, and their younger brothers often fought in the Korean War. They weren't quite old enough to serve in World War II, and so they served in the Korean War. So with that introduction, I think we might want to go to Dick Valentine, and Dick, do you want to show us those slides? We've got to go over and run the projection. You can tell me what we're seeing. So if you want to get the lights, and we'll go from there. Everybody can see the slide screen here, so if you get the lights, yeah.
Turn that just a little bit. I may want to.
We want to turn those lights up. We'll pull that plug, Dick, on that. That's going to be effect. Right over there next to the fireplace is the plug. Get those were on, so pull that plug. I think we'll be better. Okay, good. Now, is that in focus? Is that in focus, Dick? Is that,
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
I just brought a few of these to, from a great stack of them I had to show what the landscape looked like in Korea, and this was pretty typical of all of the western, western and no, I'm sorry, let me get this straight. All of the eastern part of Korea and the central part of Korea, where the northeastern part was flatter than this, but most of the fighting took place in these very steep and rugged mountains. This is the coast of Korea as viewed from Japan, or coming across from Japan. At Masan, which is at the southern, southeastern tip of Korea. That was our landfall coming across there. And these are the Straits of Korea, of course, in the foreground.
Okay.
This is same place, only just arriving over the coast. Obviously, in the wintertime, this is on one of the airways going from Busan up to Daegu or to Seoul. This is pretty typical of the countryside there that they fought in. And it's a very, very rugged country, very steep, new mountains, and just about as nasty a place as you'd want to find. Quite different, of course, than Vietnam. Vietnam was jungle and swamp. Korea was mountains and dust and coal. This is Seoul. This is on the final approach going down into the airport at Seoul. Those are some of the bridges that were bombed out in the many times that Seoul changed hands during the conflict. This is looking to the north. At this time, the fighting was several ridges to the north from what you see here. That's the Han River. That's the city of Seoul. That's pretty much downtown Seoul, and it would be interesting if we had a picture of Seoul today. It's a modern city with high and rise steel buildings and glass, and it looks like downtown San Francisco. It's hard to imagine that this city in the relatively short time after that war has developed as it has. This is K-47, which was one of the forward airports that we operated from, and the fighting in this case is just across the next ridge that you see there. This was just prior to the armistice being signed in the summer of 1953. These revetments, the sandbagged revetments, are places where they kept the old T-6 training airplanes, which were used as mosquitoes, as they call them, forward observer aircraft. This was one of the innovations of the Korean War that was not common in the Second World War. The frontline troops were given the benefit of some air power. These mosquitoes would go off with a pilot and a ground observer, and they'd fly around at very low altitude right among the hills because they were being shot at all the time with small arms fire. Their only protection was, they had nothing to shoot back with, their only protection was to get there quick and get out quick and stay low so that you didn't have much chance to shoot at them. And they would try to pinpoint the machine gun nests and the various artillery pieces that the North Koreans were using. And if they possibly could, they'd drop a smoke bomb on the nest, and then they'd call in jet fighters that were high overhead waiting for a call, and they would come down and try to wipe out the machine gun nest or whatever the enemy interference was. A very risky business. The pilots of these aircraft were generally the people that had made a lot of mistakes in flying other airplanes, and they finally ended up doing this. That's the aircraft that I flew over there, the C-46. Our primary mission there was, this was a troop carrier squadron, and our primary mission was to ferry troops in and out of Korea from Japan, to carry ammunition and food, and our perhaps most important mission was to fly aerobacks out of Korea. This is again at K-47, where the other picture was. These aircraft were surplus at the end of the Second World War. They were sold to General Chenault in China for $1 apiece. That would be $10 if you'd allow for 10-to-1 inflation between then and now. They were bought back at the beginning of the Korean War for $30,000 apiece in 1950, which would be like $300,000 apiece now. And General Chenault was made a very rich man. He also owned every part and every screw and every hydraulic cylinder that went with these aircraft. He did all of the overhauls on the aircraft down at Taipei on Formosa, and we were in his hands completely as far as buying parts and getting the maintenance on these aircraft. I would make one other comment about this, and I don't mean to sound terribly bitter here, but there is perhaps a little note of bitterness. Back in the United States, we had a squadron of brand new Convair 340 aerobatic aircraft that were completely pressurized and were, right from the design up, were made to be aerobatic airplanes. They had beautiful interiors, they were soundproof, they were warm, they could fly at high altitude. These aircraft here were noisy, they had very little soundproofing, they were not pressurized at all, we were limited to 10,000 feet altitude. We gave some of our aerobacs a pretty rough ride in order to get them back in these aircraft. But of course, it was more important to keep the new squadron of aerobatic planes in the States. That's the loading of an aerobatic aircraft. All of you, I'm sure, have seen MASH. I've always watched those MASH programs, hoping that they go one step further than what they show. And there's an important issue here, I think, from the standpoint of the people that are wounded and who died of their wounds in Korea. This was the first war where we had helicopters available to us to evacuate the wounded. That is, a lot of helicopters, good helicopters. And it was also the first war where we had the mobile MASH surgical units that stayed just one hill behind the lines. And when a man was wounded, if he could be reached by a helicopter, he could be picked up right from the place where he fell, at great risk to the helicopter crews, and brought to a MASH unit, which was nearby. You all have seen those if you've watched MASH on the television. And he got very quick emergency care in the MASH units, surgical care if he needed it. As soon as he was able to travel, he was brought to the to a base such as this. This happens to be Seoul, I think, K-16, and where they were brought in the ambulances and loaded on our aircraft and flown back to Japan to the major military hospitals that the U.S. forces ran in Japan. There were several of those hospitals, some down in Osaka and some up in Tokyo. And this was our, I say, probably one of our most important missions, was flying these aerobacks back. We had many of the men would be in litters, would be fastening litter racks on the aircraft. Others would be ambulatory, they'd be able to walk on the aircraft and be seated. We had some in striker frames, all sorts of injuries. But the reason why the deaths from war in the Korean War were much less than they were in the Second World War was because of these various factors. The helicopter, penicillin, of course, the MASH units, and the capability to aerobatic these people back to a major good hospital where they could get excellent care and begin their recovery. And from that point, they would go back to the States. This is a helicopter delivering an aerobatic. Now this man here, this is an actual incident, by the way. We had a load of aerobacks on board the aircraft. We'd started the engines, and just as we were taxiing out, the tower called us and said, "Can you hold for one more litter?" And we said, "Sure." So we did. And this man was shot 30 minutes before this helicopter delivered him to the aircraft. He wasn't given any treatment in the field other than medics picking him up and tying him into that litter. He was on our airplane 35 or 40 minutes after he was shot, and 3 hours later, he was in a major hospital in Japan, in Osaka, where we delivered him.
Did he survive?
He survived.
Good, good.
I can happily say that thanks to our angelic flight nurses, we never lost anybody on any of the aircraft that I flew. It wasn't because of me particularly, but it was because of those nurses. Good. That's loading the litter up the ramp. This is arrival in Japan at Brady Air Base, which was on the southern island of Kyushu. If you look at the chart over there on the wall later, you can see where that was. It's right across the bay from Fukuoka, Japan, one of the biggest cities on the southern island. And this is typical of all aerobatic operations. We had priority over the president's aircraft, the only aircraft in the world that could have priority over the president's aircraft. Every takeoff and every landing was followed by fire trucks and ambulances down the runway, and the Japanese and Koreans who drove those trucks just loved it. They would wind those things up and go just as fast as they would go, trying to catch that airplane either on takeoff or landing. And they were there, of course, in the event we had a problem on landing, or something, blew a tire, or some had some kind of an accident, they would be right there next to the aircraft to get those airbags off. This is a typical military hurry-up and wait picture. That was a navigator of mine, Sheehy, and a pilot friend of mine, Mandeberg, waiting for Chow in Korea someplace. I don't remember just where we took the picture. Mess kits in hand.
That's it.
That's it.
Now, could we get three veterans up here with up here at the table, and they want to come up and Dick, would you start us off? How long were you in the war, the Korean War?
Just a year.
Just a year. So what years?
I went over in September of 52 and come home in 53.
53?
Yeah.
Okay. And where were you stationed?
Mostly in an area called the Punch Bowl.
Punch Bowl, okay. And that's about all the area you covered in the war?
Yeah,
yep.
Yeah,
okay.
Pretty much.
Okay. Okay, Kirby, how long were you in the war?
Well, I landed there the 4th of January, 51, and I left the 28th of November, 51.
Okay. And you were stationed where?
Well, I was in the infantry, so I went across the 38 a couple times.
Okay.
So I was, I had to have a map because being in the infantry, you didn't know where you was.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
You didn't have the newspaper there or anything else, and the radio or anything. So you really didn't know where you were.
And Dick?
I spent 1 year in Korea, I was stationed in Japan. I wasn't stationed in Korea.
Yep.
I flew to Korea every couple of days. I went over in October 52 and came back in October 53.
And, okay. next question is, how did you find Korean geography? What was the thing that you noticed most about geography and the climate of Korea? Dick, what did you notice?
Well, it was cold and hilly.
Hilly, huh?
everything you did was uphill or downhill.
It isn't a very attractive place, is it?
I didn't think so.
No, that's what most people think. No. They didn't think it was a very attractive place. How about you, Herb? What was your reaction to Korea, geographically and
politically? Well, I landed there in the wintertime, and plus, when you're in the infantry, you're out in the open. You sleep out in the open and everything else. So there, I don't know how cold it was over there, but it was. You know, when you're out in the open, it's pretty hard to tell. Mm-hmm. And usually we were on the mountains. We were not very often on the lowland. And it seemed like after you climb one mountain, there's another mountain up ahead of you. And so we were, most of the time I was over there, I was going up mountains, and they're very steep mountains.
What's the soil like there?
Well, there's no wood over there.
No.
Because they, I guess they probably
were these
cut the trees off.
Were these mounds just piles of rocks, or were they some soil?
No, they had, you know, they had their thing on them, but, you know, just
scrubby.
Well, no, they really didn't have anything on
nothing,
them.
No vegetation on them?
Well, just the grass and dirt.
Yeah, grass and dirt,
That's all.
Pretty hardy grass and dirt, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah, well, that's what they had, that's what they burnt for heat.
Yeah, grass. Also, yeah.
If there was any trees around, we cut them down anyways.
Yeah, well, there wasn't anywhere, I mean,
because, you know,
until I get up in the north,
yeah,
then there was more trees up there.
I see. Dick, what did you know about the geography and the climate?
Well, those pictures show the geography,
yep,
and they go along,
yep,
with just what these fellows said. They were on the ground, but from my standpoint flying over it, right, there were places that were pretty.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't have been pretty if you were down on the ground.
No, no, no. Okay, next question is...
I would say this. In the summertime, the lower part, the southern part of Korea, was very green. And there wasn't a lot of forest and trees, but the mountains were green. In the wintertime, everything turned brown.
Mm-hmm.
And further north, I think it was white, pretty near all brown and white, yeah.
What opinion did you have of your fellow comrades and fellow American soldiers? What do you think of generally American soldiers? Dick, do you have any opinion of American soldiers generally?
No, everybody was in it together, and
yeah,
they worked together, and they certainly didn't have the problems that they did in Vietnam.
Yeah, yeah. How about you, Herb? You're a fellow American soldier, but we're...
Well, you did what you have to do.
Yeah.
It's either you or him.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, there wasn't any, you know, you just went in, when you went in a little combat, it was...
There didn't seem to be any divisions as there were in Vietnam. There was a lot of various units fighting, you know, competing with each other, and there was a lot of morale problems, I think. We didn't find that probably in Korea. That's what generally the view
I don't think the morale was over. I mean, we had problems with that, but we had a lot of UNs.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that in a minute. So
we had, oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Dick, did you have any comments about this U.S.?
The people that I met there, in the Air Force, were all reservists when I went over there, and I was a replacement for those reservists.
I see.
And the squadron that I was assigned to, the 344 Troop Carrier Squadron, was the Memphis Reserve Squadron. And these guys had fought one war, the Second World War, and they had thought they'd stay in the reserves and fly up to Maine to get some lobsters from time to time, fly down to the Bahamas, all called navigational cross-country flights. And they weren't very happy when the war came and they were assigned to go back to Korea. There wasn't a happy one among them. They all were middle-aged, they were all married, they all had kids, and they were just mighty glad to see us young sprouts coming over there.
What opinion did you have of your fellow UN soldiers, Dick? Did you ever meet any other UN soldiers, other nation soldiers?
No.
You didn't meet anybody?
No. All we had was a Marine beside us.
Okay.
And we didn't have a very good opinion of him either.
What about you, Harry?
We had Greeks with us.
Greeks?
One battalion of Greeks was with my regiment.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a very high opinion of
Greek soldiers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They were good fighters.
Dick, did you have any?
I had no contact.
Okay. Were you able to form an impression of North Korean forces or those of mainland China, Dick?
Oh, I didn't hear the question.
Do you have any opinion of North Korean soldiers or Chinese soldiers?
We didn't like them much.
They pretty tough, were they?
Yeah, they were disciplined.
Yeah. Disciplined, yeah.
One of the things, where an American soldier, you know, he had to crawl for 10 minutes to go 10 feet, you know, he didn't have any patience, but, you know, they'd take an hour to crawl that 10 feet, and they were very stinky.
How about you, Herb?
Well, when I first over there, we had some North Koreans, and then after that, they were out of the war. So we had the Chinese.
Chinese tougher than North Koreans?
I don't know, because we only had North Koreans for about maybe a month or so, and then we had the Chinese.
I see. The Chinese, but you saw Chinese fighting, they fought against you too, did you?
Yeah.
And what was your opinion of them? Were they tougher than the North Koreans, or?
Oh, I don't know. When you're...
They're all tough.
Shooting against the other guy, I mean, what do you know?
Yeah. Sometimes people thought the Chinese soldiers were supposedly more disciplined than the North Koreans. North Koreans were good soldiers, but the Chinese were even better, according to what some of the historians say, but I don't know.
I think they were better equipped.
Yes, they probably were, yeah. And Dick, you never ran into any enemy people like that?
All I saw were a few tracer bullets coming by. Yeah,
that was it, okay. What about MacArthur's being fired by Truman? What did you think of that, Dick? Did you think that was the right thing to do?
At that time?
Yeah.
Well, we wouldn't be sitting in this room now if it had kept on going.
Yeah.
But, 40 years later, we're still fighting over there. Nothing's been resolved.
No, not really.
And I think it had, he stayed at, we got into quite a skirmish, but it had been settled.
Yeah. What about you, Herb? What do you think about MacArthur and Truman?
Well, actually, I never knew anything about it.
Oh, you never knew anything about it?
Because I was on the front line.
Yeah, and you never weren't aware of what was going on, huh?
No. The only thing I will have to say about that under the UN, this was the UN law, and we had the enemy on the run, and then they began the peace talks. It's about maybe a month over there, when I was over there, things are quiet. And we ended up on a ridge of very high mountains, and for about 3 days we didn't hear nothing, and then we could hear them, and they gradually came back, and we could hear them over there digging in. And then later, when the UN wanted to straighten out the line or whatever, and then we attacked. And then within a week, my whole company got wiped out. So, see, that's why I didn't like the UN war, because if it, MacArthur, maybe we would have, it would have been a war, not a political war, or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, okay. How about you, Dick?
Well, the Korean War was the first war we didn't win. And, of course, the Vietnam War was the first war we lost. And I think that whether those two things relate to each other, I'm not sure. But MacArthur wanted to bomb, from the Air Force standpoint, and I'll speak from a colonial standpoint, to be honest with you, but we wanted to bomb across the 38th parallel. And I had my best friend I grew up with was flying a fighter out of Taegu, a fighter bomber. And I had other friends who were flying fighters out of Seoul and further north. And these guys would get jumped by Korean and Chinese fighters. And they would come down and bomb our airfields or our troops. And then they'd turn and run. And when they passed that 38th parallel wall of the Yalu River, our guys had to stop. You can't go across that line. And just across that line, and a few hills beyond, is where their bases were. And we were prevented. This was a limited war. We were prevented from fighting the war in any meaningful way. And I'm certainly convinced, and have been going along, that had we been able to go across those borders and bomb those airfields and wipe out those aircraft, these fellows on the ground would have had a better time. And the same thing holds for their artillery pieces. We've been able to go up there and wipe out their supply lines, they would have had a better time. And I don't agree with the idea that we did the right thing. whole thing by pulling MacArthur out of there. I think MacArthur was the smart one. I think Truman was the politician. He played with the politician. That doesn't mean that I don't still agree with the fact that, the military ought to be run by the civilian. But I think that mistake is a mistake.
Wasn't there some false information? MacArthur was under the assumption that there weren't as many troops as he thought there were, although that there actually were up there.
I can't speak for MacArthur.
Well, that's what I, Manchester, if you read Willie Manchester's book on the 20th century, you get that impression that, but MacArthur wasn't the only one. Everyone else didn't know the right, how many soldiers there were up there. Isn't that right, Paul? It was something about the troops.
Well, MacArthur underestimated that. He also, down deep inside, didn't believe the Chinese would actually do what they did. He didn't actually think they'd cross that river, but when UN forces penetrated North Korea and approached Seattle, which was the Chinese border, not the 38, they were well north of that.
Right.
They came in 300,000 strong.
That's right.
And then he wanted to use anything, nukes, anything. And that's why they got into that catfight, those two.
That's right. Okay, what impressions did you have of General Ridgway? Did you ever have any contact with General Ridgway?
No.
Ever see him? Or?
No.
He succeeded MacArthur, of course. And,
The foot soldiers, the only thing you see was the 9 to 10 guys around you.
That's about it.
That was it.
Yeah.
And, you know, you might know the whole platoon, but as a company, you never get to meet the rest of the guys.
How about you, Herbert? Did you have an impression of Ridgway? Did you have anyone say anything about it? Did you have any impression of it from what people said about it, or any hearsay that they heard?
When I was over there,
I
didn't hear a thing about it. I was in the infantry.
Yeah.
It was too busy fighting. We didn't know who was ahead of us or not. So you don't.
Okay. How about you?
No, I had no contact.
No contact with him. I was lucky when I was at QA camp up in Tomagami, Ontario. General Ridgway's son was in the camp. So he came in quite often. I ran the store up there, and I quite often had several chats with General Ridgway about career, about Vietnam. And Vietnam was right in the middle of that during that time. So he was really a really fine person, I thought. And just an exquisite man, and just was incredibly ordinary and low-key. So I felt he was very, very, very much one of the people. And one of the things that always impressed me was that the workers at the other end of the island got sick, and so there was no one to do the kitchen work. And so they came in and asked the guests to come in and help with the dishes. And who was the first person to volunteer but General Ridgway? So I thought that was a really good indication of what he was like. Okay, moving on to what was the most difficult part of life in Korea? What did you think the most difficult part was, Dick?
The cold, certainly.
How cold do you think it got there?
20, 30 below. The wind was always blowing.
Yeah.
And there was no place to get warm.
Yeah. Okay. How about you, Herb? What do you think was the...
Now, what do you mean by...
most difficult part? I mean, other than fighting. I mean, obviously, you were fighting most of the time, but was there anything else about the life that was pretty tough there?
I guess the most difficult part was that you lived like an animal.
Yeah.
You never washed. You had sea rations for World War II.
Yeah.
When you had them.
Yeah.
3 days we went without them and things like that. I mean, you don't even brush your teeth.
No.
At all. But during the year, only when at the hospital.
Yeah.
And you had a raincoat, but you kept your weapons dry, but not yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the worst part is living like an animal.
Yeah. How about you, Dick? Anything?
I didn't spend any time in Korea.
No, but did you have any impression of what some of the tough things people did? Or the cold is something people always talk about.
It was cold, and there's no question about that. And it was cold enough there that in some of those northern bases that we didn't want to leave the engine shell off more than about an hour.
Yeah.
Because we were afraid we wouldn't get them started again.
That's right.
We didn't have any heaters up there to start them with. And these weren't turbines that were operating with thin oil. These were reciprocating engines. heavyweight oil in them, and if they got cold enough, you wouldn't get them going.
Yep.
So our concern, that was our concern, and it was bitter in the wintertime.
Yep.
Really bitter.
Okay, what was the thing about your career experience that surprised you? Was anything about the career experience that surprised you, Dick?
The whole thing was surprising me. I was 17 years old and I'd never been out of Bethel before.
Oh, that's right.
Bad surprise.
Bad surprise, yeah. Okay. How about you, Herb?
Well, what do you mean by that question?
Was there anything about the career experience that surprised you? Did you have any preconceptions about career and you found something totally different? Did you, that's what I'm trying to see, if there's anything about it that surprised, maybe it was a happy surprise, but most things weren't happy. Maybe something about the place.
Well, I think from after I came home and I watched the war movies, there was a surprise. Because over there we never had rank, the officers never had any rank or anything. You see the movies, they got their ranks and their
division badges.
The division patches, the officers had their the mark, but back of their helmets, and it isn't anything like the movies.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were...
Those white patches on the helmets were good targets for the officers.
Well, we didn't, they didn't have it.
No.
I mean,
no.
My outfit. The officers, they acted and they acted like the rest of us.
Yes. What, did you have anything surprise you, Dick, about?
Let me go along with what the other gentleman said here. My biggest surprise, perhaps, was my first flight as a qualified aircraft commander. I had a grand total of 750 hours of flying time, and I had not felt that I was qualified to fly that aircraft and carry passengers and things like that quite yet. But the guy I was flying with and assigned to fly with, I figured was going to kill me because he had lost his nerve. He was beginning to come apart, and so I decided the only way to save myself was to accept the responsibility. So I did, and my first mission, which was a surprise, I reported down to base operations at about 2 o'clock in the morning. I looked up on the board, and there was my name, aircraft commander Valentine, and here was my co-pilot, that was a bird colonel. And I thought, whoops, they got something wrong here. It turns out that, yeah, that was the case. And so this bird colonel came up to me, and then I didn't know what to do except salute, so I saluted him. And he saluted, shook hands. He said, would you like me to go get the in-flight lunches? And I thought, well, that was one of the lowest things you did in preparation to take this flight. And I thought, I didn't know what to say. I thought, well, I'll go get the in-flight lunches. And I thought, I really shouldn't ask him to inspect the aircraft because he was getting his 4 hours a month, and he really wasn't qualified to inspect the aircraft. So I said, well, I guess so, sir, if you don't mind. So he went off in a Jeep down to base ops to the in-flight lunches while I got over my fear and went around and checked out the aircraft. And when we crawled aboard, I sat down in the left seat, pilot seat, he sat down in the co-pilot seat, and I guess I was going to say, sir, would you begin to read the checklist or something like that? And he said, now look, Lieutenant. I was a second lieutenant. He said, now look, Lieutenant. He said, out there, he said, it's got to be yes, sir, it's got to be salute. He says, in here, you're the chief. And he said, my first name is such and such, and your first name is such and such. And let's keep it on that basis until we get off this airplane again. I said, yes, sir. He said, ah. So that was the biggest surprise I had, I think. And we had, he flew with me then for the next whole 3 or 4 months. Every time he needed to get his time, he would sign on with me, and we had a nice relationship. Had a good time flying together.
Do we want to say any more about the cold? We had the question about the cold. I think we covered that pretty well. Let's move on then to what impression did you have of the folks back home? What do you think they were thinking about the war? Dick, did you have any?
I don't think they thought anything.
No? You didn't get any impression that they were thinking anything about?
I was gone for a year and I come home and it's just like I'd been down to a ball game in Boston.
That was it, huh?
Yeah. Way you bet.
How about you, Herb? I bet you had a different story. Huh?
No. Because I didn't know.
You didn't know what people were thinking back home?
No, I just got letters and that's all.
Yeah. From did you learn anything later about what people thought back home?
Well, that was I didn't, personally, I didn't come home very happy, but now it's been all these years, and I can look back, but I lost a lot of good people, who I knew.
How about you, Dick?
No, I don't agree with what they say. I think when you're over there, you don't have much input as to what the political situation is back home and how people feel. The only thing you know is what you get from mail.
Yeah.
It comes from your family and your friends. And they didn't really discuss the feeling in the nation, whether the war was to be the forgotten war or not.
Okay. Final question is, what would you say the most important lesson of Korea was? Dick, anything? Any lesson you think we should learn from it?
I would guess don't get into a situation that we can't either win or, one of my feelings was when after I'd been there a while, that what we should do was go lay down South Korea and just start working our way up north and shoot everything in front of us. I didn't like the South any better than I did the North. You couldn't trust them, and couldn't turn your back on them, even the South Koreans. They, when you really needed them, a lot of times they wouldn't be there.
How about you, Herb?
Well, I think that's probably true. I think the only thing I can really think of, say is if you're fighting a war, you should fight it to win. And just, you know, we were having the at the first hit when I was I don't know why we would blow the 38th, and then we went up over the 38th, and then the enemy pushed us back, and we went back, and for about a month. We was after the enemy, and then they began the peace talks, and as I told you, we were up on top of some mountains on the line, and for about 3-4 days we didn't hear the enemy, and then we could hear them over there, and then somebody down the headquarters wanted us to take some more mountains to straighten out the line, and when I was over the hospital, then I read where my whole company got wiped out. So I think it's if you're gonna fight a war, it's not peace, no, like I did.
Okay. Dick,
did
you
have? I think it ought to be said that one of the reasons that we got into this Korean War was the fear of the domino effect. At least that was my understanding at the time. That Eisenhower was very concerned about this being the first, that is, the invasion of South Korea, being the first step in a bunch of dominoes in the Far East that might fall, and where the communists would take over one country after another. And during the Second World War, we'd seen that happen. And we watched Ethiopia taken by Italy, and we watched Poland and Czechoslovakia and Romania, and all of those countries that fell in Hitler's way before we finally got into the war when we did. And the Japanese, of course, come into the war besides. And there are those who feel that we came very close to losing the Second World War because we waited too long. We know now that the Germans had jet fighters that they were actually flying, prototypes of, prior to the end of the Second World War. Had that war gone on another 6 months to a year, there's some question as to whether we would have had control of the skies over Germany or not, because those fighters were so much faster and more maneuverable than ours. I think Eisenhower realized that and was concerned that if we let Korea fall, and it might then be Vietnam or Cambodia, some of those other countries, it might be Indochina, it might be the Philippines, perhaps finally Japan. And we should have learned after the First and Second World Wars that we can't allow the enemy to collect that much real estate and that much manpower and raw materials before we step in and do something about it. And that's why we stepped into Korea when we did, to stop the first domino from
call me. Whether that was justified or not is history, I guess that's the cause. That was one of the things I think you learned in that year.
Another thing, we weren't equipped to go in there. I can't remember what year you was in there, but...
51.
51, but when the guys, the first winter, you know, they didn't, you know, they had fatigues and summer shoes, you know. You know, we never should have gone in there until we had the equipment to stand up to them. Time I got there, we did, you know, we had decent clothes to keep warm and decent sleeping bags, but...
You could call that the second hand, Wolf. All of the materials and equipment that were used in that war were left over from the Second World War. And the aircraft that I was flying was a classic example. Doing one of the most critical jobs over there, carrying wounded back out of the country with a junk airplane. I loved that airplane. It was a great airplane. But it wasn't the airplane that we should have had to do that job, and there were such airplanes here in the States. I understand that we were using munitions and shells and bullets left over from the Second World War that had been in storage for a long period of time. And there were plenty of misfires. Dud shells, dud bombs. My friend was flying old fighters out of Daegu during the early part of the war. It wasn't until the war was over that he ended up with a modern jet fighter. So we were fighting that war with secondhand equipment. And we started out with secondhand people, guys who had fought in the Second World War, and really were not very enthusiastic about Korea. So I think we had that against us also, certainly in the early part of the war.
But they took people out of Japan that had never had any basic training.
That's right.
They were clerks or radio operators or something like this. And, you know, next thing you know, they're over there.
Sure.
There was such a drive to demobilize after World War II that
and that's one of the lessons.
Yeah, we really went way too far that way.
Absolutely.
We should have stayed.
We should have maintained some level of military readiness.
Right.
But after a major war, of course, that's what the politicians want to do. They see all that military money there just waiting to be grabbed and spent for social welfare programs, and that's what they do every time. We should learn by now that there's a danger to that. A danger after the First World War, a danger after the Second. After the Korean War, and then Vietnam, of course, which we lost. So we do need to maintain a certain level of military readiness and the development of new equipment right along, whether we're actually in the war or whether we aren't, to prepare for what may be the next one.
I received a letter from Guy Merrill answering the questions we set forth tonight, and on his number 10, which was the one about what lesson do we learn from Korea. And he said, like all wars, war is hell. So I think that's a good way to summarize the Korean War, as not as much as any other war being a total hell, and that's certainly says it all, I think. We have people in the audience that might like to ask a question or make some comments. Does anybody like to make a comment or question? Roger.
I got one for Herb. How close, distance-wise, did you actually get to the because it looks like those mountains. I wonder how close your mind.
Okay, now, what we used to do when we used to go up a mountain, we would spread right out and walk up the mountain. That's the truth, Joe.
You must have got pretty close.
Yes. Nobody in between us. When you're in the infantry, I guess they say no man's land, but there isn't any no man's land. It's either you or he. No, you just, you know, as I said, those mountains that one has, not when you just, the whole company would spread right out and walk right up. No protection at all.
Wouldn't there be a problem of vehicles getting support vehicles?
Vehicles?
Had no vehicles over there. It was
artillery or?
It was a. Yeah, but they were way behind us. See, Korea was an infantry war. The way you have mountains, because you can't get the tanks up there close enough. We had the tanks up there once. Once, and then they began to get, the enemy began on them, and they just withdrew. So Korea, in the year 1951, was with an infantry war. You walked up there. We went, when I got over there, we would blow the 38 parallel. We walked up above it. And then the enemy went on offensive. We walked back, and then we walked up again. And so I was in the infantry, and I walked most of the time. 99% of the time, I walked.
A glaring contrast is the Gulf War. The Gulf War was all done with tanks. Everybody rode, in weapons carriers or personnel carriers, and that was flat land, desert land, no hills, wide open. Open to air power, open to tanks, and all that sort of thing. None of that in Korea.
To get to Roger, one of his questions there, about the distance, we was on top of the castle, Sand Bay Castle, and the enemy was like 75 yards away, but it was probably, I don't know, thousands of yards down and up to the other side of that, and we used to take a pot shot and stick them on the end of the rifle and look and take the pop shot at them. Just for something to do, keep break up the monotony. After a while, we were told not to do it anymore.
Another question.
Yeah, I was in Korea.
Oh, you were in Korea too? You should have been there.
1960 to 62, because it was after the war.
I see.
But condition wise, it's basically what they just said.
Yep.
So, I spent most of my time on the DMZ.
So the South Koreans didn't appreciate
having
you being there?
Yeah, I think they did, because I used to see refugees when you was going up there, those poor refugees would be coming from the north. Yeah, I think they did. I think they really did. They bought the houses, they bought everything. Yeah, I mean, you could... The refugees would even come right through the front lines from the north.
Yeah. Other questions? Anybody else got any questions? Herb, you might just tell us what some of these things are. We have a number of things I photocopied, and would you just tell us a lot of
Well, these are, when we took a hill, we used to find the propaganda, and if you people want to come up, and some of this is ours, and some of this is theirs, and there's a letter from a Mrs. Hebert down in Auburn, I think was very interesting. It surprised me when I read it. These were on top of the hills, which we took, propaganda.
Is that a Carlin Natilla shell, that one in?
What's that?
What was that one in? Because they used to... They used to put these in artillery shells and shoot them at us.
I don't know, these are on the...
And they would explode and come floating down by the thousands. And we used to have a grand time picking them up and using them for personal things.
How about the money? What was that all about? What's the money over there?
You've
got some money there.
Well, I got some North Korean money,
okay.
But I
don't know. I wasn't sure what it was, so, okay. Yeah.
It's got the ham and sickle right there.
Okay. Not Korean money. Okay. So we also have an album from Eldon Greening, so we may want to take a look at that too. So I think, anybody have any other questions or comments at this time? I invite you all to come up and talk to the people, and I want to thank this group for being such a good panel. You got to give them a hand. So.
Because we had some soldiers, we had some children. I thought that their mothers would send them. Arlene made some dollhouse cookies. I'm sure some of you got those sent to you. And we got some bars. And the only thing, I wrote to my granddaughter, and I asked her for Korean recipes. And so she sent me some, but the Koreans seem, for dessert, they seem to use mostly fruit. But I did make some Korean candy, so it's ginger, but I'm going to tell you, it's spicy, but it's ginger. So, but it has some, and that will bring it up, yeah.